Hello there, APUSH students. So today we are going to go over the Gilded Age and dealing with politics. So all of the notes and things you've been reading about with period 6 for AP US history is that all of these things we're going to see a lot of connections and stuff today with what we're looking at. So definitely be taking notes. If you have questions, definitely tell me the timestamp. All right, and send me a remind message of my question was at this time, and so I can give you a better answer. All right, so our issues in the Gilded Age politics, our issues are down here. All right, we got monetary policy, so that's dealing with money. Obviously, you can see from the background, we're dealing with money. The government is very corrupt, right? That's why you had the reading on Boss Tweed. We have issues with tariffs, right? Tariffs, one group of political parties are gonna like it, another group isn't. We want to regulate our railroads so it's fair for everyone, and we also have unions that are happening, and you guys did your web quest on unions. All right, so this slide here, normally I would have had this printed out for you guys that you would then be putting it into your notes. So with this particular topic here, we have the Republicans and Democrats. We're going to group these guys together, right? And the reason we're grouping them together, it's because they're not really that different at this particular time period, right? If we look here for number two, all right, okay, they both are pro-business, right? So they're going to love everything with business. They're not going to try to regulate business at all, because if business is good, the economy is good, and that's really all that they matter, right? They're looking for sound currency. Sound currency is like hard money, right? And when we talked before, hard money is this idea of having gold or silver, right? Not using soft money or paper money, right? So that's going to have more financial backing, right? Again, government's doing very little to help people out, right? However, as long as they are doing stuff that helps out businesses, they're happy to go, right? The Republican Party, however, is going to splinter, right? So splinter groups are where we're splintering like a piece of wood, right? And we have these three groups here, right? Now, these three groups are fairly odd, right? The stalwarts, basically think of them as stalling, right? Okay, they're going to be your traditional Republicans, okay? They're going to be also pro-Grant, right? So they're, you know, think stalling, right? Your half-breeds, I realize this is not Harry Potter, right? It kind of sounds like it a little bit. Your half-breeds are going to be kind of wishy-washy. They're going to be pro-Grant, which means that they're part traditional. However, they want reform. Right? And with this reform, they want to get rid of, they don't like the spoil system. All right, and remember, the spoil system was set up by Andrew Jackson. All right, he's the most known for it. And that's when you won a political office and you got to give all of those jobs to your friends. Right? And that can lead to corruption, because sometimes those people aren't going to be honest with you, and other times they might just tell you, you know, they might not have experience either. So we're going to have some problems. All right, our mugwumps, again, I know it sounds a little like Harry Potter, all right, but our mugwumps are going to be anti-Grant, okay? They're going to be, they don't like the spoil system, right? And they want reform. So almost think of these three groups, one, two, three, as a progression, right? So these are guys, the stalwarts, they want to stall, they want the old stuff of what's going on. They're okay with the spoil system. So we'll even add that in here, all right? That they like the spoil system, because they're probably benefiting off of it. Your half-breeds are kind of like, oh, we like Grant, we like the old traditional things, but we want some change. And then the mugwumps are just like, no, we want all the change, right? Where they came up with these names, I don't know. If you can Google them and find out, please share with me, all right, because this is a time period that's a little weird. Right? Over here on the left side is the populace, right? You can take a screenshot of this and look at it a little bit later, but we're going to get into the populace later on through our notes today. But basically, the big thing, remember that they're the farmers, right? And the farmers are pro-silver, right? Because they think silver is going to help them out more financially. Right. And then they're going to want all sorts of changes. So they want like the direct election of senators, which will eventually become the 17th Amendment. Right. They're going to want all these things called the initiative, referendum, and recall. These are things we're going to talk about in the progressive era. So that's going to be in a little bit. Right. Not today. Right. And they're going to want a lot of control over the railroads, because they feel that the railroads are taking advantage of them. So think of the railroad tycoon. We're thinking about Vanderbilt. Okay. All right, here's just a kind of a thing when you're reading to see who's voting for which side, right? And we've seen some of this stuff before. So like when we see the nativists are gonna be here on the Republican side because all the immigrants are on the Democrats, right? African Americans, even though they're dealing with segregation and Jim Crow laws and aren't voting, they're gonna still vote for the Republican Party because that's the party of Lincoln, right? So this is just kind of like, keep that consistency of like who is supporting which party. All right, so we're gonna do a little review here, okay? So number 18 president is Grant, right? He is a Republican, hence the R, all right? So 1869 to 1877. Remember, he had all these scandals. He wasn't really to blame for them, but he wasn't a very good president because he was a good general, right? He didn't know all the other things. And when he is president, that's when we're gonna see that division of the Republican Party. Right. Number 19, Rutherford B. Hayes, again, another Republican. All right. He's going to be from 1877 to 1881. He becomes president because of that compromise. Remember, we kind of talked about that being a another corrupt bargain because that's going to end Reconstruction. Right. The Republicans thought if we can control the White House, right, Reconstruction will still happen. However, we are going to have a recession that's going to go on. The economy is not doing very well. And so they're going to abandon Reconstruction because they thought, well, heck, it's been there for a while, right? Shouldn't the Southerners have it together? And obviously we know that is not the case, right? To give you some review from your web quest, right? We have the Great Railroad Strike, right? It's going to be happening during this time period. Okay, that Great Railroad Strike is, again, we're just going to see this constant situation with workers not getting treated fairly and then them trying to unionize and strike for their rights. Unfortunately, during this time period, they're not going to get many of these rights, right? The Bland-Allison Act, right, we're going to see that a little bit more later on as well. That is going to be where we're going to be talking about the coinage of silver. And when I mean coinage, this is like coining silver coins versus like printing money, all right? It's basically the creation of that money, right? And then we're gonna see several court cases today as well, all right? So this video is gonna be kind of long because one, it's my first time doing this, but also because, you know, we got some court cases and things, all right? Munn versus Illinois is dealing with railroads, right? And those railroads are going to have no restriction. We're gonna try and make it where nobody is gonna be favored and get a better rate from the railroad company than anyone else. So no favoritism, right? And this is going to be dealing with inside of the state. So Munn versus Illinois is any railroads going inside of the state, here in particular Illinois, right, have to be all the same. So all of, like, however I'm charging you for a railroad or someone else is charging you from railroad, it should remain the same. And again, inside the state. The inside part will make more sense in a bit, okay? All right, number 20 is Garfield, right? Again, another Republican. He is only in office for a small period of time because he is assassinated, right? He is, when we say a compromise candidate, what this means is that not everybody was really thrilled about him. However, they thought he would do a good job of kind of unifying the country. So remember, we just had Hayes was president. Reconstruction just ended. We want to still kind of work on that unity. So that's like what a compromise candidate essentially means. He's going to be assassinated by this guy down here. All right. This guy, I'm not going to try to pronounce his name. I'm going to mess it up. All right. But he is a stalwart. All right, so remember, we just saw stalwarts are going to be those people that are pro-Grant, right? Also, they're pro-spoil system, right? Well, if the spoil system is going to be going away, this guy is going to lose his job, and he is not happy about it, and then he kills the president. Right? So Garfield dies, right? So Arthur, who was not meant to ever be president, becomes president. He's not going to be that great about it, but he does one thing. We only got one thing for Arthur, right? The Pendleton Civil Service Act. This gets rid of the spoil system. Now, if you want to have a government job, you have to take a test. You have to have some sort of background so that we know you're actually going to do your job properly, right? So that makes sense. One thing for Arthur, we get rid of the spoil system. All right. Now we get to Grover Cleveland, right? We have a Democrat here, so hence the D. But he's not going to really act like a Democrat, okay? So we have right here the laissez-faire Democrat, right? That's basically the Democrats at this time period, they were not laissez-faire. They weren't hands-off. So basically, he's a Democrat, but he acts like a Republican, right? So, and again, that's why we put earlier in the slides that the Democrats and Republicans were in the same column, because they're very, very similar, right? When he first comes to office, there is a scandal, all right? And this is where this phrase comes, and you'll probably see it in your book, all right? Mama, where's my paw, right? Well, for this guy, oops, I messed something up. Right. So for this guy, he comes into office and there is a scandal that he has an illegitimate child. Obviously, we don't see these sort of things nowadays, but at the time it was like, oh my gosh, what's going on? And so it was this scandal to kind of a smear campaign. It didn't work. He still got elected. Okay. And so at the same time, we're still going to see some more disgruntledness with our workers, the Haymarket riot. Right. So again, going back to your web quest on labor unions to go review that. That's going to happen in Chicago. And the people are going to actually be fighting the police. And it's just going to be a hot mess that's happening in Chicago. We're going to see a lot of these things all happening in Chicago, Illinois. Right. And that brings us to our next court case. It's again dealing with Illinois. So earlier we had Munn versus Illinois that was inside the state regulating the railroads. Now Wabash versus Illinois is outside of the state. So that means between your states, you're going to be able to regulate the railroads to make sure that everybody's getting fairly charged. Right. No one's getting a higher rate. No one's getting a lower rate. Right. So we're going to then create a new agency, which we still have today, the Interstate Commerce Act, right, with the Interstate Commerce Commission, or the ICC, right? So this act creates this commission, okay? So at least they have the same name, makes their lives a little easier, right? And what this is that now the national government is stepping in saying, we're going to control all commerce, which is trade, between the states. Right. And this we're given this power through this law. And it's because of this court case, Wabash versus Illinois, saying that we should have these rights regulated. Okay. I know there was a lot going on there. It'll be OK. All right. So Cleveland is one of these few presidents that he has two terms in office, but he's going to have a hiatus in the middle. All right. So it's going to be a Cleveland, Harrison, Cleveland little sandwich. So we had Cleveland earlier. Now we're going to have Benjamin Harrison. This is the grandson of the other Harrison president, the guy who's only in office for 31 days. All right. So with this guy here, again, another Republican, only one term in office. All right. And with him, we see the very, very first. All right. And this is a big deal. Right. Very, very first. Time that we were ever regulating business, right? And the federal government's doing this. And this is with the Sherman Antitrust Act, okay? So this is saying that monopolies are illegal, right? And we're going to review how that's going to impact labor unions here in a moment, okay? The McKinley Tariff Act, all right, he's going to have this as well. Remember, tariff is a tax on imported goods, right? And so this is actually meant to try and help our farmers and help our businesses. It hurts the farmers really, really bad, right? And so this meant to be doing something good, but it actually hurts the people it's supposed to help, right? During his time in office, we also have the homestead strike. This was at the Carnegie Steel Mill, right? So that was with U.S. Steel. Again, going back to your web quest, again, kind of another review with that, right? The homestead strike is where Carnegie is going to stop any union activity at any of his steel mills, and he's going to bring in the Pinkertons, and the Pinkertons are like a hired military, hired militia, if you will, right, to put down this strike. And so he's going to stop any union activity at any of his plants. Okay? So not a good thing for our unions right now, right? Well, Grover Cleveland, he's back, right? I'm back. Okay. And so again, he's going to have two non-consecutive terms is what we call this. So he's number 22 president and number 24, right? When he enters into the presidency at this time period, we have the Panic of 1893, right? This is going to cause a depression for the next 6 years. And so this depression that's happening, it's so bad that actually we have private enterprises are going to bail us out. So who bailed us out of the government? Right. Pause it right here. See if you can answer. And the answer is JP Morgan, right? So JP Morgan, which, so look at your other PowerPoint on big business. JP Morgan, he's at the very, very end. He is going to be bailing out the government. He doesn't ask for the money back, but he's basically trying to get their favor, right? And basically holding something over their head. So really manipulating what's going on. Definitely a robber baron type of act. Okay, the Pullman strike, right? This was one I told you guys to focus on in your guys' web quest. And so with this Pullman strike is that the workers at the Pullman Palace Car Company, right? So it's a railroad company where they're making these cars for people to ride in, is that you had to live at the company town. Well, if you lived at the company town, right, then you work next door at the company. Makes sense. Sounds like a good idea. It goes bad because the company is going to increase your, or actually decrease your wages and then not lower your rent. So now you owe them more money than you're making, and they're the ones controlling all of your money. So obviously they're going to strike. They actually are going to shut down all railroad traffic in and out of Chicago. So that seems pretty successful. They're getting national attention. Cleveland actually pays attention, right? So Cleveland's over here and he's actually like, what's going on? Now, when Cleveland starts to intervene, he will send the military in to stop the strike, and he brings in lawyers. Bringing in lawyers sounds okay, but what ends up happening is that those lawyers take that Sherman Antitrust Act that we saw with Benjamin Harrison. They're going to take that that Antitrust Act and say that these labor unions are controlling a segment of the economy. They're controlling the mail. They're controlling these railroads. And by controlling a segment of the economy, isn't that what a monopoly is? So they're going to be twisting this law to stop monopolies to really use it against labor unions. So labor unions are not going to be able to strike because of this particular law. So it actually backfires for them, right? So labor unions are trying really hard during this time period, but they just are not going to be very successful, right? In our cartoon here, let's take a moment and look at this, right? We have a laborer here. He's being held down with debt. The ball and chain over here, this is interest. So again, the interest you're paying on your debt, and he's on the road to pauperism. Remember, we talked that the word pauperism in class means the poor, right? So it's the road to poverty, essentially. And back here, it has like mortgage and things like that. And he's at this tombstone saying, here lies prosperity, enslaved in 1862, stabbed in the back in 1873. So that's the crime of 73, when the government did not back silver coinage of money. Assassinated in 1893. That's going to be that depression we're going to see, right? By John Sherman, Sherman Antitrust Act, Grover Cleveland, president, and other traitors in Congress. So this is basically the this cartoon goes along the idea that the people are not prosperous anymore. So that's why it's titled Here Lies Prosperity, right? Hopefully that makes sense. And again, whenever you look at cartoons, always look at all the different labels of what's going on, right? So that was all of our presidents at this time period. So now let's go into the populist movement, right? So for our populists, right, we have here the rise and fall of the Populist Party. Again, the Populist Party are going to be your farmers, right? So on our little map down here, I'm going to make it bigger just for a moment, right? We can see where our Populist Party is being victorious. So the darker green colors, we're going to focus in on Kansas here, right? It's all going to make sense here soon, but that's going to be kind of like your hub or centralized location for your Populist Party, right? Again, your farmers. Okay, so what are their problems? Okay, all sorts of basic problems here, right? Your crops aren't worth any money. If you can't get any money for them, you don't have any cash, right? If you don't have cash, you're going to be in debt, and then your house is going to be foreclosed upon. However, what's unique with farmers is their house is also where they work, right? So if you don't have the farm anymore, you don't have a job, right? And you don't have a place to live. So things can get real scary really quick, right? They're all pro trying to get these railroads under control because there's no regulations. Okay, so their demands, regulate the railroads. Definitely highlight that guy, put stars around it, glitter, all sorts of things, because that's going to be a big main demand, right? The next thing, they want more cash available to them. So they want dollars, right? Paper dollars to be backed up with silver instead of gold, right? Gold is just going to be too scarce, right? They're not going to have availability to it. However, silver, they can get their hands on silver. And so That's why they're going to be pro silver. If this part here is starting to get a little confusing, you should be reading the article on the cross of gold, which is in your packet, right? That article I picked out for a reason. It goes over this monetary policy really, really well. It's from an economic background, and it's to help you guys out because some of this stuff with like the silver versus gold can be a little confusing, right? So definitely go back, reread that article, definitely take your time with it, all right, because I put it in there for a reason, right? Their demands, they have some pretty basic demands. I think these are good ideas, right? So single term for president and vice president, because remember, there are no term limits at this point in time, right? We don't get that until the 1950s, right? A secret ballot, right? So this is where it would, if you vote in any type of election, no one knows who you voted for. That makes sense. We have that nowadays. Popular election of senators. That we are going to eventually have, but we have it nowadays. So again, these are things that they wanted. We have versions of these now. So they were just a bit ahead of their time. And then they want the industrial workers to help them out. So they're going to say, okay, well, we want these things that the industrial workers want too, so that they'll join our team. And all those things make sense. Okay. All right. Our issue with silver, again, we're going to kind of review some stuff from before. All right. But again, we want to, you know, have all this stuff on here because sometimes this issue becomes a little confusing. All right. So the crime of 73, the government stopped coining silver. So we don't have any silver coins anymore, just gold. Well, you either get gold or you get paper money. And we know that that paper money can change in value quite rapidly. So that's not going to be really good for you in the long run, right? And we saw earlier the Bland-Allison Act, right? They're going to start coining some silver, but it's very limited, okay? So kind of in a positive direction, but not as much as they want, okay? Right, so then we have our election of 1892, right? And so here we have multiple people running for president. Always look at your key down here because the colors don't always align with our modern politics, right? But you see that the Democrats are the blue, so lots of the South, lots of the East and everything like that. Republicans are red, you know, very much in this northern area here. And then we have the populace. When was the last time we saw a third party get electoral votes? It's very rare. So for this, right, that populist party is holding some weight, right? Now we always know the electoral vote is what matters. So here the blue wins, so that is Cleveland, right? And so what the, so Cleveland here with the Democrats are getting this election, okay? But people are starting to pay attention to the populace, right? The following election cycle, 1896, right? The populace are going to support the Democratic Party because, again, they want to have a win, right? And they are going to have all put all of their coins in one basket behind this guy, William Jennings Bryan. He's going to be in that article in your packet as well, right? And this guy's all about silver, right? This guy is known as like this really great speaker, right? You can kind of see in here, he's just like, you know, yelling and everything like that in that picture. Okay. And then this image here, this cartoon is also in that packet article, right? And it was because he had a speech called A Cross of Gold, right? And basically he's going to use a lot of biblical allusions in saying that this burden of a gold standard is like Jesus holding the cross, right? And carrying it with him, right? And so it's a burden on the people or the average everyday Americans, which are your farmers, right? Now, if we look at our map over here, right? A lot is going on this map. Okay. All the blue is William Jennings Bryan, right? Looks like you got a large portion of the country. Think the Southerners here, all right, your sharecroppers, lots of your farmers, your populace out here, again, lots of farmers. However, it all depends on that electoral college and it depends on population. So remember all those numbers, they add up, right? McKinley will win this presidential election, okay? So he loses but carries most of the South and the West, right? And so 1900, eventually we will have the Gold Standards Act, right, where gold will be the number one product in the United States. We will be backed by gold for all of our paper money. So we got our little cartoon here of gold triumphing over silver, right? Nowadays, we do not go by the gold standard. Our money is backed by faith in the rest of the economy. So hopefully in these trying times, it does not worry you too much, right? But we are not on the gold standard anymore. It haven't been since the 70s, right? So it's been working out pretty well. So let's keep our fingers crossed, all right? Here we just got a general list of why the populist movement declined, like most third parties. All right, it is going to lose some favor here and there as times and topics change. All right, so again, the economy is experiencing a lot of change. All right, small producer farmers are going to go away, and now we're going to start to see bigger farms. All right, there's a race divide. Okay, racism is going to be in a lot of these things we talk about. Right? The populist parties out west, right? In the south, you have sharecropping. They're not going to always get along. Okay? The populists aren't able to break existing party loyalties. What that means is that once they have gotten attached to the Democratic Party, they're not really going to be able to break away from them. Okay? And their agenda was co-opted by the Democrats. What co-opted means is that the Democrats were like, oh, those are good ideas. We're going to take them too. And so they're not going to be the original ideas of the Democratic Party. They're going to be the ideas of the populist movement. Okay? And our last thing to wrap us up is a little bit of stuff about the Wizard of Oz. Right? So the Wizard of Oz is actually a parable, all right, for the populist movement. I know it sounds a little weird. If you have never watched the movie The Wizard of Oz, use this time to maybe watch it. Because it's a classic movie. It was made in the 30s, to be honest. It's like, it's really, really old. But we're going to have over here just kind of like an idea of what the different characters are. So like the tornado that tears everything up, that's for the idea of the panic, right, in the late 1890s. Dorothy's supposed to be the American people. Toto is supposed to be kind of the one that saves us all. Kansas is where the movie takes place because that's where the populace started, okay? The woodsman is the industrial worker, right, who has no heart because he is part of the machine, right? Your scarecrow is your Midwest farmer. Actually, in the book, the scarecrow saves the day at the end, and he is left in charge of Oz, right? Oz itself is the abbreviation for ounces of gold, right? In your article, it talks about William Jennings Bryant being the Cowardly Lion, right? So a lot of roar, a lot of talk, not a lot of action, right? The Yellow Brick Road is for the gold standard. Her slippers are not ruby in the book, right? They are silver, right? And that's for the silver standard. And it's the idea where she could go a long way in those shoes. Obviously, the movie made them red because it's in color and it just looks better on screen. The Emerald City is going to be where all of the stuff is happening, where we're making monetary policy. That's going to be Washington, D.C. is going to be the Emerald City, right? And if you've seen the movie or if you plan to watch it, when they're singing songs in the Emerald City, is everything's kind of like la-di-da. They don't have any work and they're not really focused on anything, right? And the wizard in the Emerald City is the leader of Washington, D.C. So it's the president, right, is the wizard. And the Wicked Witch of the West, she is going to be the person that is going to be hurting the environment and everything like that. And so that means she is going to be the railroads, okay? So the Wicked Witch of the West is the railroads. And the flying monkeys that she's going to control are going to be the Native Americans. I know, it's slightly problematic, right? But it is an interesting way to think about this movie if you're familiar with it. Again, if you're not, all right, I would advise, like, it would be kind of something fun to do is go watch that movie with mom and dad and talk about it maybe. But if you don't have access to it, it's not a big deal. My last slide here, I'm going to put this link for the Crash Course on the Gilded Age Politics on the bottom in the description below this video. Definitely, I would say watch it because this particular time period for the politics is a little thick and can be daunting when we're reading through stuff. So definitely, I hope this you guys are giving me questions to answer. And then again, at the end of the week, I will go over those questions in another video. All right. And other than that, good luck, guys, and send me those questions. Bye-bye.